ever imagine all life as you know it stopping instantaneously and every molecule in your body exploding at the speed of light?
Total protonic reversal.
Protonic reversal.
Protonic reversal with your host, Conan Neutron. Broadcasting from a secret underground lair in Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
A gigantic middle finger to everything that is rotten about music, rock and roll, and corporate power.
The thing is, though, if you don't laugh, you're going to go on a killing spree with sharpened nails.
Confidence of a hero or a fool, I wasn't exactly certain which.
Could not be more professional.
It means something.
And they got away.
You know, that's my take on it. Like, what's yours?
Protonic reversal!
That's like a science thing, right?
That's right. It is a science thing. It is a science place. It is a scientific fact. We are all up in your face. It is time for the one, the only... Protonic reversal. Welcome to it. Fantastic guest tonight. It was agreed to spend a little time in the good old protonic reversal hot seat. Returning guest. Been a while. Mr. Craig Wedren.
Hi.
Sir, how you doing, man?
Good. How long's it been? Couple years? Year? Two? Three? Four? What?
It has to have been because I think Josh was still doing the show. I think which he was the co-host.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right.
So I've been doing this on my own again for about 140, 150 episodes. I can't remember exactly. So it's been a while. Let's just say it's been a while. How about that?
Yeah.
You've had a lot going on, but let's start with the most recent stuff first.
Sure.
You got a new single, man. It's awesome.
Yeah, I'm doing a whole singles series for about a year. I decided rather than put out a record, which is, you know, such a sort of Herculean monumental task when, you know, mixed, paired, and balanced with life, work, family, that given the way everything rolls out nowadays, why not just focus on one song at a time? So I'm going to be doing that for, during COVID, I don't know, basically about 15 or 20 songs, kind of up to about 80% done. And so I'm just finishing them and making videos for all of them. I figured out how to make videos during COVID too. So I got a nice little, good little factory of one happening over here.
It's a dream factory, really.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's some pretty good use of COVID time if you taught yourself to do all the video stuff, because it looks pretty great, man.
Are you using when I say taught myself, I taught myself in the same way that I sort of taught myself how to sing, play guitar, write songs, and score films, which is to say I flung myself off of the side of a building into the fun ravine.
the fun ravine, yes.
Yeah.
All hope to dwell.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it occurs to me that the latest one, go insane. It's got a very Shudder to Think kind of vibe to it. Like,
yeah, it's very Shudder to Think. There were a couple of years ago, I got this Marshall plugin, and immediately, like, I was working on a TV show when I got it that was like the opposite of Shudder to Think in many ways. And I think it was a sitcom. And so I would just kind of keep my Les Paul in my lap. I was so excited by this plugin because when I plugged my Les Paul into it, which you can see behind me, it would just Shudder to Think songs and parts and riffs would just kind of come flying out. So I just sort of kept it in my lap for when I needed a break from, cute pizzicato music, and then just kind of, or while the computer was doing something, I would just kind of noodle, and all of these Shudder to Think-y parts that I was really excited about came out, and I kind of put them in a bucket and shared them, or put them in a folder and shared them. I shared them with a band a couple of years ago, and everybody was psyched about it, but of course we're all flung to the four ends of the earth right now, and so there's no way to really get together and work on stuff. And they were sort of like, these are awesome, you know, send them around once you have them more together. And by the time I had them more together, I was like, well, I mean, I'm just going to do this because I'm doing it. Yeah.
Missed the boat, fellas. Missed the boat. Yeah. But that is, I mean, I think it's an interesting, all you guys, it's an interesting case study of keeping something interesting as that band was going, but everyone kind of doing their own thing. And I mean, mm-hmm. like, for lack of a better term, adult about it. I always think that's always kind of inspiring. I think a lot of listeners to the show would probably agree. It doesn't seem like there was ever any, you know, major behind the music style drama or anything with that band.
No, I would say our behind the music style drama was fairly minor relative to, you know, it would not be worth an episode.
Right.
But it was real. But I feel like that had so much more to do with our 20s, you know, and with Nathan and I in particular. We had been best friends since high school, and we were too similar in a lot of ways. It's like when you have two people in a band who are, you know, when the Venn diagram is, I don't know, how do I do it? If there's too much overlap in the Venn diagram of like different characters in the cartoon, right. Then you're like, why are there two different characters in this cartoon? And so
the writer just put into one character.
Yeah, exactly. And so I think by the end of Shudder to Think, Nathan needed to do his own thing and I needed to do my own thing. Those happened to be the exact same thing. No surprise, because we'd been doing the exact same thing at the same time on parallel paths or together or apart since we were like 15 or 16 years old. So, I mean, that was the biggest interpersonal drama. But then, you know, the other drama was just like we were approaching 30. We weren't selling enough records to inspire Epic Sony to give us money to do more of what we wanted to do, which would be to make more Shudder to Think records, produce other bands, start scoring movies, and make our experimental side projects. And so, you know, that's like boring drama. That's not the kind of drama you want to watch on VH1. That's the kind of drama, like you said, that's just like grown-up time.
Yeah, exactly. And nobody, it doesn't make for a great dramatic story, but it is real, and it doesn't make it any less important just because, you know, nobody crashed a car into a swimming pool or anything.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it was definitely deep. It was deeply felt. But, you know, the other thing is I suspect that any fledgling business or any creative sort of collective, you know, whether it's a band or a startup company or, you know, like a burger truck is going to have like a lot of the same drama. If you're starting it with your friends in your teens and it's like, and you're fortunate enough that it's successful enough to take you through your 20s.
Right. It's something where that relationship is going to grow and change.
And I think those are sort of the atom smashing years.
Right. Understandable. And you did a good, actually, you know, I remember now, last time we spoke, you had just done that retrospective of my 90s.
Oh, yeah, right.
The photo, because it was Mr. Jared Hand. That,
Yeah, that's right.
Friend.
That was really fun. I loved my 90s. That made me feel happy. It makes me feel happy to, like, get things out of the out of storage and into the world.
What were some of the things that kind of struck you as like, oh yeah, this, wow, like, was there any like create epiphanies of just things that had been lost to the
ends? No, because I'd had those photos. I'd been looking for something to do with those photos for years, and so it's not like they were sitting. There were no great discoveries. Like right. I had them all, you know, digitally transferred, and they were sort of on my computer, and it was like, oh, what do I do? And then, you know, I decided to do the most old-fashioned thing in the world, which is to make a book.
What a book! There's a rich in story history of it, and it's actually very fascinating. I had, since we talked last, I had Jennifer Finch on. She's been, really, really amazing eye for photography.
Oh, really? I didn't know that.
She's really great. And Lori Barbero's been putting stuff together for a thing that I may or may not be.
Oh, man. I love those gals. I haven't seen them in like 25 years. God knows.
Yeah, I dig it because it's, and especially as someone that kind of, I'm a little younger, so I kind of came at the tail end of like all of that. Mm-hmm. But it's harder for the younger fans really maybe to get as into the moment of it because it wasn't overtly documented in the same way. Like, right. Sure, iconic, like, you know, okay, Charles Peterson and like whatever, mm-hmm. Yeah. all the photographers that did a great job showcasing these moments and these snapshots in time, but it's not like how it is now, where like literally everything is,
yeah,
you know,
yeah, yeah, like you want to vomit. It's just like it's too much. It's just fodder.
So it's all the more interesting, especially with a band that, you know, again, from my perspective, like Shudder to Think was a very mysterious band. Like, oh, yeah. These guys, what are they up to? Like, oh yeah. My god, like cool and neat and scary and. Wow.
Yeah. That's except we were really just like, you know, the dorks.
Right, well, exactly. But I was coming from the West Coast at the time, so I was, you know, I didn't have any intel, which is, almost makes it more fun in a way.
For sure. I mean, you know, look, the bands that all bands are just filled with dorks, really. I mean, if you're cool, your band probably sucks. But I like a little bit of, I like mystery. I like to wonder. I like to wonder and dream about my heroes.
I think that's, you know, yeah, it's. I wonder if that's being taken away a little bit.
I don't know. You know, I was listening to, there's a great podcast that I listen to a lot called, what's it called? It's called Interdependence. Holly Herndon, who's a composer and a singer who I really like, and her partner host it. And they talk to a lot of younger creatives, largely about like digital stuff, like creativity, philosophy, NFTs, like whatever it is. And I was listening to one this morning from a guy, and their guest was a guy who used to work at Spotify and is now starting a new music platform that's, what's it called? I don't know. But basically the premise is it's more about art or artists. I mean, artists, not like the term artist that Spotify and, you know, the like artist creator, not that, like actual music that has had some sort of like meaning or cultural or critical impact over the years. And so it's a place for geeks, basically. It's like a platform for music geeks. And they were talking on this podcast quite a lot, actually, about scarcity versus,
oh sure, yeah,
you know, over sharing, I guess, and you know, the sort of irony that you need to kind of like be visible and in the mix and omnipresent until you don't have to be at all, and then it's better not to be. You know,
yeah, the model that's pushed these days, right? I mean, I think the Spotify CEO bro said as much.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And they were just talking about Frank Ocean and Kendrick Lamar and, you know, people who were sort of everywhere until they didn't need to be, and now the sort of, you know, they're like creative gated world kind of serves them or you know, sort of plays into the like, ooh, what are they doing? Or, you know, what's he building in there?
Exactly. Fantastic reference, by the way. Yeah. When I think about that, the only people that really seem to lean into it, you know, certainly there's like a St. Vincent, right? Mm-hmm. Like, you know, any that level where they're sort of curated, almost David Bowie like persona.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I think like Bowie is, you know, consciously or not, like clearly her sort of you know, the sort of precedent for her. So she's interesting because, like, she's clearly intentional in terms of presentation and often present, if not, like, always present or over-present, but still mysterious, which is probably more her personality. Like, I don't feel like we're getting a totally manufactured
right
thing. You know, it's just
digging into something that there's I hesitate to use the word, but authenticity behind. Yeah. But she's presenting it in whatever manner she chooses to put forward.
Yeah, like the fantasy projection of ourselves, which is like the fun of what we get to do.
Right, you know, absolutely.
Like, that's the fun of making videos that I've really been enjoying. Because, I mean, really, I'm just sitting here all day in my pajamas, as we all have been. But I get to make these videos, and it's like, oh, I still get to kind of fantasy project, which is really great thing to still be able to do at age 51, you know, with a family.
Yeah. Yeah, so speaking of videos, can you speak a little bit about the Go Insane video? Because it's got a very interesting kind of arc to it. Like it's got some interesting visuals. Like it's definitely, did you have any of that in mind? Like when you were composing the song, or was it something where you're like, hey, let's just put something cool and see what sticks against the wall?
Well, I mean, I sort of, the way videos have been going, I'll get like one image to start with and I'm kind of flying blind, but I'll start by, you know, getting that image up and running in whatever, kind of ill-conceived or like wrong-headed form, you know, like I'll have an image and right. Then the execution of said image usually is completely different and takes it in a totally other direction. But then from there, it's sort of a breadcrumb trail leading to itself. So I don't know, I haven't watched it in a while, but the lyrics to Going Sane were about, for me anyway, it was sort of a reminder to myself to very basically just like unplug and fuck it, you know.
Yeah.
like don't believe the hype, don't take the bait, you know, do not click. And not always, but like, yeah, to just make sure that is part of the part of like the meal plan. And so I don't remember what the first image was, but I guess it was right after the Capitol riots.
Oh, yeah.
And that I was starting, and so I just was, you know,
yeah, thing that happened 3 months ago, right?
Yeah, I know, 3 months, 3 years, 30 years, I don't even know. And so I just kind of started with like the most basic, just grabbing images and went from there. And so, but it sort of goes from external surreality to internal more serenity, and chaos, color, noise to, you know, let's say like fire to water in the course of the video. It's not quite that overt, but that was sort of what I was playing with and what I was aiming for.
Do you ever take inspiration video wise from other places? Because I mean, as someone that you know works with film, like you know scoring, yeah, like it has to, like the intermelding of the two has to kind of just be,
yeah,
something
it's irritating. Always there. And once I started making videos, I realized that part of the reason I've always been frustrated and mortified making videos is not because I don't like making videos, but because I want to be making videos myself. Like I don't want to cede power. at least at first I didn't. Once I started actually editing videos, I was like, oh my God, this is so painstaking and exhausting, but I still love it in a sort of extension of the my 90s. It's like moving Polaroid photography,
right?
But it's much trickier that like my photos are so lightning inspired And this is like, you know, a whole weather system, like a video. It's not a moment. And it's a lot to pay attention to because, you know, with a photo or with a Polaroid, it's just one frame that's being composed. And with a video, it's like I can't go in there and compose every single frame. That would just be annoying and precious. So I'm still figuring it out, but I'm really enjoying the process in the meanwhile. Like, you know, ultimately I sort of want it to do the same thing as my photos or my songs or my lyrics or Shudder Think songs or whatever, which is to kind of capture and release. It's like while you're watching it, you're captured and inspired, but the idea, as opposed to, say, the internet, is not to, like, keep you on the hook, but to, like, then inspire you to go out and repollinate, you know? Go ahead. What did you say?
I was just going to keep it moving. I just, like, you know, pay it forward, you know?
Yeah,
like,
exactly. So I'm hoping that the videos do that. I certainly have not, I mean, I guess I've been thinking about them in terms of promotion, but not really. For me, it really is just like a more of a visual art exploration. I wish I knew more about how to shoot and edit, because I feel like, you know, with each video, I'm learning little new tricks, but
right.
But it's still, there are times where I feel like I'm just repeating the same moves.
Well, I mean, that's a discipline in and of itself, isn't it? I mean, like I editing.
I guess so. And I, you know, it's like, I guess it's no different than starting anything. It's like you repeat the same three moves and then you discover one new move and then you got four moves to repeat. And then eventually after 40 years, you've got like, you know, nine.
Yeah. You see, doing something cool. Oh, how did they do that? Let's figure it out. You know, it's like, mm-hmm. It's like the punk rock philosophy.
Yes. Yeah.
Well, but it just strikes me as that, like, it's kind of continuing a through line of like strong visual aesthetic for a very long time. I mean, I go back to, and I apologies, I can't remember if we talked about this before or not, but just how disarming and different the ex-French t-shirt video was.
Yeah. It's so like, funny.
It's so eye-catching. You're like, what? Like if you were to watch it on mute, you would think it's a totally different kind of band.
Yeah, what would you think, I wonder? I have no idea. It's such a hodgepodge. I saw some of it recently, and, you know, I loved that video at the time. I mean, I still do love that video, but, I mean, it's just steeped in sort of not 90s-isms, not like other 90s music videos.
Yeah.
But just in that same way where if you listen to Shudder to Think, it sounds, you know, the sounds, which is to say a Marshall and a Les Paul, it's those 90s sounds. And there were those kind of visual touchstones too then. So it's hard for me to separate the era and my experience and our experience of that era from watching that video. So I don't have any objectivity.
Well, I could just say as someone growing up in an uncool part of California at the time in the Central Valley, when I saw it, it definitely was like a what's this?
Good. That's good, because that's what we wanted to do, and the director wanted to do that too. Everybody involved in that video was on the same page. It was such a nice experience, and we made like real friends on that video. My favorite Shudder to Think video is the Nine Fingers video. I don't know if you've ever seen that.
I've seen that.
That's my favorite one because we just did it with friends in a little theater space that we were doing a play in. My girlfriend at the time was had written and was directing a play which starred most of the state and half of Shudder to Think. And so we just used the set on a day off. And I think it was David Wayne and Mike Jan and Tom Lennon kind of co-directed it, if I'm not mistaken. And that one, probably because they were all of our friends and they, you know, we were basically all completely enmeshed and the state and Shudder to Think were completely enmeshed, that it just quite naturally reflected and expressed what the band was, the sort of light and dark.
Yeah.
The mystery and dorkiness, as opposed to being like too much one or too much the other.
Yeah, yeah. No, that's, I think that's an astute observation, because they're well, and there's a lot of kind of in, like dichotomy between things that were, you know, presented as like a full force mesh.
Mm-hmm.
With
yeah,
that may be like, you know, the truest to the spirit of the band in yeah. that way.
I think so. It's the one where it feels least like we're trying to do something.
Sure. Well, but it is also, well, and that's an audacious record. One thing I distinctly remember from talking to you last is the wild factoid that the record company wanted Hitlicker to be first. Yeah. Of like, wow, that is like the least commercial song ever. I mean, I love it.
Like, it's, I know. I mean, it rocks. It's definitely a statement of intent.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You're like, you know, like whatever. I'm trying to think of like lame stuff around that time, but I think I purged it all around my memory. But it's sort of like, yeah, that stuff, this is not. Like, we're thing, and here it comes.
Yeah, if you're into this, the rest will be easy. we're starting with the big hill. Yeah.
Well, and it just occurs to me that like I played that record for some folks in the van on tour, you know, back and like two of the people had not heard it before, and they're like, "Wow, what's this? This is great!" Like cool. it's really well in the way that it's still just like poof, like, you know, just uppercut.
You mean fairly recently?
Yeah, yeah, like a couple.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, and I mean, the whole record slams. Like, don't get me wrong, I mean, but as far as opening. It's Hall of Fame for me.
That's awesome. Thank you. I mean, I would bet that, you know, people probably have an easier time listening to it now because everything's less siloed and rigidly categorized.
There was a lot of genre cops.
Yeah.
At that time, weren't there? Think about now, like with everything being like I feel like, I don't know. Would you agree that like maybe Beck helped like knock down some of those walls?
Oh, that's interesting. I'd never thought of that, but I was thinking about him yesterday or a couple days ago, because in the course of a day, just happening like in the car, Devil's Haircut came on, and then at home on the radio, Lost Cause came on, and so I was thinking, you know, about all of his different. You know, Beck's approach always felt quite sensible and natural to me. You do what you're interested in when you're interested in it, and then you move on to the next thing.
Right. This is good for this for half a song, then I'm going to do something else.
Yeah, totally. But that's interesting in terms of knocking it out. I mean, I would say, I think probably it's more the internet than Beck. And I would say probably more iTunes or the not iTunes, but the actual iPod, the shuffle factor of it. I think the shuffle feature is one of the most unsung revolutionary things that has ever happened to music.
Mm.
Because it 100% changed the way everybody listened to music. And you had your entire record collection or MP3 collection on there. And so almost instantly, everybody realized that they were listening to a much broader swath of aesthetic material than they had given themselves credit for. It's like you're listening to The Clash, you're listening to Johnny Cash, you're listening to Bach. You're listening to Joni Mitchell just because they're great records that you have, but when you're only listening to them one at a time or in a different phase of your listening life, you think, oh, well, I'm into folk or like I'm into funk.
Sure, sure.
When you smush it all together, you're like, oh, look at that. I kind of like everything.
Booker T followed by Slayer, followed by The Resident, followed by, you know.
I mean, that is the dream. That was the dream. That was the Shudder to Think band.
Yeah. Well, and that's, it's interesting to me that also the few times I've run into bands that claim you guys as an influence, they're always very interesting. They don't sound like you guys, which I think is hard to do, but I'm always like, it's almost like it's a cultural touchstone in a way of like, oh, going to be, all right, let's pay close attention here.
Like, that's a high compliment. I mean, it's that catch and release thing. It's like you want a capture and release. You want to capture and captivate, inspire, shake everything up, and then toss it out the window and watch the balloon explode, and then everybody makes their own weird shit, which is that's the fun thing.
Well, and the weird shit didn't end, you know, with the band. Like, would you say that? And I had forgotten. First of all, sadly, as important as they've been in my life, I'd temporarily forgotten about the state, which was fantastic. Mm-hmm. But was the association with those folks that kind of helped pave the way a little bit towards, you know, your next phase in life?
Oh, yeah, for sure. I mean, those were all of my friends that I went to college with, and most of them were in film school. And so I was always like just doing like little crumbs of music for student films. And when before the state was the state, they were called the New Group, and they did a lot of black box theater stuff. And so occasionally I would do music or sound for a skit here and there. And then by the time Shudder to Think was had it with the kind of machine, and we started wanting to write music for movies, a lot of those college state people were starting to write, if not quite yet make their first movies. But then that naturally led into Wet Hot American Summer, which Teddy Shapiro and I did. Teddy was also composed a lot for the state. And so they just threw us together in a room and
higher and higher, man,
and made us write the high watermark of both of our careers.
The pump of jam to end all. Yeah. Which is quite the accomplishment and no mean feat. I mean, I used to think about, like, in terms of, yeah, I you know, this would be a van game before the era of podcasts and whatnot, where you're just bored senseless. You think to yourself, hey, what kind of song do you wish you would have written? Mm-hmm. And things like you know, moving in stereo and fast on high. I'm like, oh, how great would that be? Oh. But like, you did it. I mean, higher and higher is like, I mean, you know,
it's our moving in stereo.
Party's over. That's it.
we knew when we wrote it. I remember the day we wrote it, and we were just laughing. And Teddy said to me, he said, so what do you think about the fact that we just wrote the best thing that we're ever going to write? And it's a joke.
Yeah, exactly. But it's a joke, but it doesn't make it any less of a good song. It's
That was like the beginning of like a whole parallel career for me for a while of writing. I know that song. Like, I love that. Wait, no, have I heard that song? Wait a minute. Is that even a song? Wait, that's a joke, you know, like that you can't tell and that eventually you're just like duped.
Well, and then, you know.
But then you want to go back and listen again.
Then you want to keep listening to it. Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, I think that the Velvet Goldmine stuff's fantastic as well. And I threw on the Maxwell Demon song and I was like, fuck, this is a fantastic song. This is like, How Dare to Be Stupid was like one of the best Devo songs, but Weird Al. That's one of the best Bowie songs, man.
I always wonder whether he ever heard that song. Cause I feel like that's a really good Bowie song too.
Yeah. Man,
you know, it's sort of all the young dudes and what, there's some Aladdin Sane-y about it. I don't remember quite what it is, or no, not Aladdin Sane. It's very like Diamond Dogs and all the young dudes, and I felt good about that one. I'm not nuts about my vocal performance on it. So what's that?
Really? Why four?
Well, I just remember recording the vocal in the studio and feeling like I needed to, and maybe it was a note from somebody. Oh, I think it might have been a note. Yeah. So We'd been asked by Randy Poster, wonderful music supervisor and friend, to do these Bowie-esque songs for this movie. At the time, we didn't know whether they were going to use my voice for that or whether what's his face was going to sing.
The actor.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. For Nathan's song, Hot One, I think it was always clear that it was going to be Nathan's vocal, I think. But for mine, it wasn't totally clear. And I think I had gotten a note to maybe pull back on the Bowie-isms in the vocal performance relative to what I had done in the demo.
Oh, interesting.
I could be wrong about this, but if memory serves, the demo was a little more full on, like closer to a Bowie channeling vocal. And so I remember recording my vocal and feeling uncomfortable because it wasn't quite the way that I naturally wanted to sing it. And so I was never thrilled about the way the vocal came out. And then Jonathan Rhys-Meyers wound up re-singing it for the movie anyway. So, I mean, I may as well have done the vocal that I wanted to do.
Well, I think it's wonderful. Personal.
I mean, I like it. I'm not saying I don't like it. It's just that thing where, like, you remember the discomfort of the moment.
Well, sure, absolutely, yeah. But it is something where, and that's such a wild movie because I feel like that would have been a really, really huge hit if it come out a little later, maybe.
Yeah.
But I feel like there's there's going to be an incoming resurgence or reinterest. I don't know what the word for it would be. Pretty soon. As these kids today,
right? A reappraisal.
A reappraisal, especially with gender fluidity being more common now, and both advances and disadvances with trans rights and things along those lines.
Yeah.
I think we're gonna be hearing more about it.
That would be really sweet. I love that movie. There's so much vision and heart. And amazing music. I mean, that soundtrack still really holds up.
Yeah, I mean, I as much as I like the movie, it's like that soundtrack kicks, man.
Yeah, I gotta hand it to Randy Poster, who, in my opinion, is a genius. I remember when he approached us about that, and we were like, A, of course, and B, why would you ever attempt to do that? Why would you ever attempt to re-record Roxy Music songs, whether or not Radiohead is doing them, or a T-Rex song? And then everybody knocked it out of the park.
Yeah.
It was just such a special, special thing. A similar thing happened when Randy got in touch with me to do the School of Rock. And he sent me a script for it, which was Mike White's script, and it was great. I loved it. But it also felt to me like, maybe it wasn't quite finished, it seemed very open, like it was going to be so much up to the up to Jack and like the chemistry of like the whole crew. And I remember I said as much to Randy, and he was like, dude, shut up. This is going to be amazing. And B, it's going to be the funnest, easiest job you ever will have. And you're going to thank me forever. And I was like, okay. And he was completely correct. It's the best.
That was movie. Kills too. That was like, on cable, I don't know, one of these months during quarantine. I was like, hell yeah, I'll watch School.
I know. You can't not watch it. You can't watch 5 minutes of it without watching the entire thing.
Absolutely, it's totally one of those kinds of movies, and it's something that it hits a kind of an important current in American culture that is both referential but sort of like kind of sweet.
Yeah, it's so sweet.
And like it's something where I would be hard pressed to be like, who hates this movie? What monster would ever hate
nobody.
This?
Nobody. You can't not love that movie. It's like. For me, it's like Grease. Like when Grease comes on, I'm like, this makes me feel so good the whole time, and I have to watch the whole thing.
Yeah, strap in. Let's go.
Yep, totally.
I wanted to speak a little more, something more recently. The Cat Stevens to New Amsterdam. I mean, how did that come to pass? You know, obviously,
so,
a songwriter, but there's some kind of people are really into Cat Stevens, you know, so.
Yeah. So basically, I and my team, we composed the music for New Amsterdam, which is a wonderful show on NBC. It's a medical drama, again, with like just a huge heart, kind of everything we're talking about. Yeah, it's like a great, great, big, good intentions. And they usually license us. They always license at least one pre-existing song per episode, in that way the TV shows do. And in this one, I think there were a couple songs that they had temped in, and by temp I mean it's like a song that's put in as a temporary hold that either gets licensed or gets replaced by me and Jefferson and Alex, my team. And so in this case, there was a scene where they used almost all of the original Cat Stevens version of that song. And everybody loved it, particularly the showrunners. One of them's a very big Cat Stevens fan. And so, but there was something that wasn't 100% working about the arrangement within the scene. I don't know what it was. If like the strings were stepping on the dialogue, or if it got a little too florid at a certain point, you know, because it's like tea for the tiller, man. It gets florid. And so as simple and understated as a lot of it is, there's like a lot of detail going on under the hood. And that can compete with dialogue often. So we were in what's called the spotting session, which is when you sit with the director and the producers and the music supervisor, and you go scene by scene and you talk about what the music should be in this scene, whether the temp music is working, isn't working, and what we can do to change it. So we were going through it, and the showrunner was like, why don't you try doing a cover of this song for it? Because we really love it. And he didn't have to ask me twice, because while I have a complex relationship with Cat Stevens, like I have extreme mixed emotions about some Cat Stevens stuff. Just in part just because there's that tendency in early 70s, particularly male, particularly singer-songwriter, sensitive artist stuff, that's like nauseatingly, condescending.
Yeah. What's up, James Taylor?
Yeah, I mean, I love Cat Stevens, I love James Taylor, but like there are times... Yep. Where you're like, stop talking down to me like I'm your baby girl, you know? And especially stop talking down to young girls like that.
Yeah.
It's gross. And I'm sure that he would agree at this point. It's just like a young man's, it was like a moment in time. And that said, there's some beautiful, beautiful poetry and language in it.
Oh, hell yeah.
I had never really heard this song before, or I'm sure I have because I've heard the album, but I never clocked it, right? Also, as like a dutiful punk rocker in the 80s and 90s, I was like, fuck those hippies, whatever.
Yeah.
So I was really excited to dig into it and do it, and it turned out that I love that song, and I was wrong about Cat Stevens, and I was so happy to kind of... investigate, take apart the watch, and kind of rebuild it. I mean, it's a pretty faithful cover, But it definitely also feels like me and, you know, my friends who played on it. So I was happy with it.
And of course, you know, song replacement. But, you know, when you're doing original composition and things along those lines, how much of it is informed by what's on the screen? Meaning, like, you know, like a Reno 911 versus like a Roger Dodger or something, right? Like they're not looking for the same thing.
Right. Well, it's interesting with Reno. We actually just did like a ton of new Reno stuff because there's a new season coming out soon. With Reno, I make everything beforehand. They're just like, give us 80 pieces of Reno music between 2 and 8 seconds long. I'm like, okay. As opposed to something like Roger Dodger, where it's like you go real deep into a scene and you really shape it around the internal character stuff that's happening, but also the external action stuff that may be happening. And that's like a whole other game. The Reno thing is super fun. I think Reno's the only example of that.
It's kind of a rarefied era of shows. About it, as at least ones that use heavy utilization of music. I mean, sure, there's like It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia or something, but they don't do the same kind of thing.
Right. I mean, a lot of shows will use pre-existing libraries. Like I think a majority of reality shows, they probably just have a library, you know, like a drive filled with cues.
Yeah.
And some of them have smiley faces and some of them have frowny faces. And some of them have like fast written next to them and some have slow, and they just grab them and like cut them together and they edit to those library cues. So it's always fun to make a prescribed library, you know, for Reno.
Right. Yeah. Cause you have an idea of what the thing's going to be and you can kind of.
Like we know the world, like Reno's Reno, you know, it is so reliably Reno. It's the best.
Love it. Definitely.
You know what you're getting and you'll watch the new season and you're like, it's just more awesome Reno.
Right. Which good on them. You know, they're in a killer thing and they have leaned into it as much as one can lean into the thing. Mm-hmm.
I love it. It's
like, to me, it's like, you know, a punk rock band that starts selling more records, but they don't like change what they're doing necessarily. Yeah. They just find their audience.
The difference being that I feel like with most bands that sort of hit a formula or hit upon a hit formula and then wind up trapped in having to repeat it.
Right.
I never get the sense with Reno.
No, they seem like
seems like they're just having a ball.
Yeah.
And it's totally infectious. It doesn't feel like they're like, oh, we got to put on these short shorts again. It's just like, I get to put on the short shorts again. Who would have imagined, you know?
This is a great day. Taking ditches. And it's something where. Like there's artistry to it, but it gets to kind of serve, God, for lack of a better term, like a more proletariat comedy function as well. And that, there's something to be said for that. I think I like that kind of stuff.
Explain that, please.
Well, I think that like there's a tendency amongst certain segments of music and certain segments of film or comedy or something to really want to go the high-minded is important.
Yes. Yeah, for sure. I am guilty of that sometimes.
Yeah, absolutely. But I think it kind of runs the line of being like, this is stupid as hell, but it's brilliant at the same time.
Well, I think I feel like a lot. I'm thinking back through the output of former State members, and I mean certainly.
Look at Ken. Party Down. Party Down was like that's like. Flint record or something, you know?
but that's not like Reno is actually for the audience that watches the shows that it's lampooning, which is amazing.
And it
succeeds. I feel like Reno 911 could heal the wounds of this nation, could could sew us back together.
The great unifier, yeah. Well, and it's, you know, so it occurs to me, and if people are wondering, other than because it rules, why we're dwelling on Reno 911 so much, is because I kind of feel like Shudder, like, walked that line with, you know, you guys played with Fugazi, you played with Pearl Jam. You were that, like, you could play in both playgrounds.
I guess so. I mean, Pearl Jam happened to get huge.
Yeah.
But I think, ironically, Pearl Jam at this point is more like Fugazi than, you know, lots of other, than most other massive alternative bands.
That's true. You they know? Walked the.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, they sort of turned out, like, you know, for music aside, as an entity, they're like a combination of Fugazi and the Grateful Dead.
Interesting. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. No, I can see it.
I just mean in terms of the way they kind of do business, the way that they present in the world. I'm not talking about, like, the style of music.
No. But all the people that they're associated with, the fact that, you know, that it's a family, like, more than anything else. Which a lot of times when you get to, like, you know, bigger acts like that, maybe that is less common. You know, sometimes, but.
I mean, for sure. I'm trying to think of people I know who are wildly successful. There's definitely a family vibe in a few of those cases. I haven't been in touch with Pearl Jam guys for years, but I have to say, like, I'm very impressed by how they've handled themselves.
I think that stuff matters too, and I think that's something that. I mean, you remember back in the 90s, oh, so-and-so sold out. You know, they songs in an ad where it's like, now even the idea of it, you have to explain it. Okay, let me get out this chart and diagram, and I'm going to buy a big deal. And everyone's like, what? We don't get it.
Yeah, it's so interesting talking to my son, who's 12 years old, about that.
Right. You know?
Or the other day we were having the Green Day talk. And
time we talked about Green Day.
Then it's time to talk about Green Day. You don't need to know about the birds and the bees. You need to know about the Descendants and right. Green Day.
We're going to talk about Bill Stevenson tonight.
Yes, exactly. Because he was just like, you know, when we have dinner, we usually put on a single artist and listen to it. And the other night, I was like, what do you want to listen to? And he said, oh, this isn't Green Day. And we were like, okay. And so we put it on. I'm like, we can listen to Green Day, but I need to bore you.
Yeah. Could have come with a prefacing lecture.
Yeah, right, exactly.
Here's what you need to know about this before you.
Son, before you go out to this party, this is a condom. Yeah.
Exactly. You gotta make sure the kid comes prepared.
Yeah.
You know, make your own decisions, but come in prepared.
This is a banana. This is Green Day.
Really, something we haven't talked about that I think is very fascinating is the Sabbath Sessions. And I wonder if you could speak a little to that. What inspired you to do that and how that developed?
So Sabbath Sessions are live, improvised, vocal looping, kind of ambient choral meditation music that I like to make. Really, it's just kind of the latest iteration of something that I've been tinkering with since I was a teenager, when I used to plug a microphone into a 2-second sampling delay pedal and fiddle around with it. And then in college, I would do a lot of kind of ambient, I was in a performance art program. So my friend Rick Nance and I, we would do a lot of, like, ambient sound theater, just sort of sound installation type stuff. And then I made a record in, like, 1995 called The Spanish Amnesian, which was, like, a lot of sampled experimental and ambient stuff. Some of it more on the noise end of the spectrum. And so I always really, really enjoyed vocal layering, harmony, free improvisation, and choral music, and so, but technology was, there wasn't an easy way to do that. And I don't know, maybe 10 or 15 years ago, Dave Siddick from TV on the Radio had this had this great looping pedal, which I think you could loop for 3 or 5 minutes or something. And he gave it to me. He just gave me, he had multiple copies of it, or whatever you call it. He had multiple pedals. And so he loaned me one indefinitely, and I just started getting way, way into playing with it. But I would pick it up, put it down. They broke a lot, so I didn't quite take it out of the garage yet. But I realized that, like, very slowly and very and also it was just my improvised harmonic composition.
Yeah.
It took a long time to kind of figure it out. And so I would do a thing where I had like 2 looping pedals or like 3 looping pedals and 2 microphones and 3. It was all very clunky and extremely exhilarating and fun. At the same time, I was getting into like a fairly regular daily meditation practice. I mean, just proper meditation, sitting for 20 minutes. And then gradually the two began to merge, and I don't know when that started, but over the last maybe 5 to 7 years, increasingly, I would find myself doing these vocal looping performances with friends of mine who were yoga teachers or meditation teachers, or just like parents like on the school camping trip who just needed to lie down and chill out for an hour.
Have a moment.
Yeah, exactly. And I always loved it, even when it was horrible and noisy and like terrifying. But what I started realizing is that it was really having a positive effect on people in the live space, especially if they were meditating or drawing or painting or writing or like doing some personal, you know, work at the same time. So it became this like very non-performative musical performance, I guess. And then when COVID hit, well, I started a podcast around it, because I haven't really been able to figure out how to put it out into the world. It makes perfect sense, but right. It doesn't really fit on an album. I don't quite know, you know, some of them are super long, some of them are 2 minutes long, some of them are 2 hours long. So I've just sort of continued to do them and hopefully continue to get better at and refine them. And then during COVID, I just started doing them live every day for a while, finally put out a record of them. And I'm now doing just bits and pieces now that I'm kind of back to work, like I do it when I can.
Yeah, because I mean, it occurs to me that I don't think I've ever seen anything quite like it.
That's great.
In a good way. And it seems like it really hit, I mean, for lack of a better term, critical mass, like during COVID times and time when people kind of needed, you know, everything else going on to get centered or to have like something to on it. And just the necessity of the culture and meeting the moment and being the perfect sort of thing of like, oh yeah, the looping technology has allowed this to happen as well.
Yeah that's right. Looping technology and streaming technology. I mean, we wouldn't have been able to like live stream something like that with halfway decent audio, you know, even a couple of years ago.
Well, and clearly I'm a podcast fan, but I mean, to a certain degree, it's a niche audience, and the fact that it can just be like a thing that shows up in the internet, and like you're either like, oh, cool, I want to see that, or like, oh no, I'm not for that, or I can't do that right now. Yeah. Like it's there as a communal experience at a time when there is no tactile physical community.
That's really great. I appreciate the reflection back, because it was a very strange feeling doing them because it was solitary, but not solitary.
Right, because you're kind of doing into the void to a certain degree,
yeah,
right?
You're sort of doing it into the void. And I could kind of see who was on. It was very nerve-wracking. And sometimes I would feel great about it, and sometimes I would just be embarrassed. But, like, that's part of the deal that I made with myself. That's what that form is. It's improvised. It can go off the rails. That's okay.
Purely ephemeral. Like, it's yeah. meant to, like, it's not only meant to be in the moment, it's meant to be more in the moment than things are normally in the moment
yeah.
for.
Yeah, that's right.
Nice.
It's like in the moment from moment to moment.
Right. You know,
it's like, okay, that last moment was really wild and now it's like peaceful again. You know, that I really like that. And for me, just the meditation practice of observing, kind of watching the weather, whether it's inclement or sunny skies, to yeah. learn how to, and as a perfectionist too, or a former perfectionist, to learn how to do that while making instant music is a really challenging exercise and like exhilarating exercise for me.
Well, it seems like it's almost a public service as well. And I think about, you know, I'm certainly interested in many forms of meditation, even though I'm crap at almost all of them.
Mm-hmm.
But one of the things I find disdainful of a lot of, you know, the TM advocates is that it requires, like, there's a barrier of entry. Oh, you got to like pay a fee to get your mantra.
It's a lot of money.
Yeah. I mean,
a lot of okay. money.
And I get that, like, oh, but you're buying yourself, you know, mental well-being for yada, yada. Yeah. Yeah. I get it.
Well, but, and the truth is, like, with the David Lynch Foundation,
and I adore David Lynch.
So much of their money goes to getting meditation into schools where kids are in, like, very real trouble, you know, or into, like, camps in South Sudan or whatever. So I mean, fair enough. So if I know where that money's going, and but still, most people can't afford it.
But then, yeah, then I think about things from the perspective of someone that maybe needs something like that. And yeah. they're not in a position to even have someone know that they would need, like, a grant to do that. Or, like, hey, this person's being in this program. And here's just a thing that shows up on, whether we like it or not, the people's platform.
Yeah.
It's here. If you want yeah. it, it's here. Like, that's... Yeah. That, for something that has commodified almost everything, like, that's a lot of it. And that's something that's you know, I'm surprised that nobody's put a stop to it yet or found ways to, like, monetize it or whatever. But I don't have a question there. I just wanted to throw that out there.
Thank you very much.
Really freaking cool, man. And
thank
like
you.
I think you're uniquely good at it. And it's also just, I mean, not to put too fine a point on it, but there's some artistry behind it. And, like, it's clear that there's some thoughtfulness behind how it's put together. I mean, is there like, do you have an idea of where you're going to go with some of it? Or is it just
never,
kind of.
Never. I mean, I have, like, habits, and so I wind up repeating them, but I have no, I very quite deliberately go in with no idea. And then I let it rip and I try and listen
yeah.
and respond.
I don't know. I can't think of anything like it. And I think it's actually a good use of the internet.
Thank you.
Of which there's very few times that I feel that I can say that in
Thank
this
you
life.
Very much. Thank you.
I want to be mindful. Speaking of being mindful, I want to be mindful of your time. I know.
Yeah, I have to go, unfortunately.
It's so and that's fine. We won't make it like 3 years, whatever the hell it's been since the last time for yeah. the next. Craig, this has been awesome. The last thing, it's the only canned question I ever ask. I don't think I was asking this when you were on last time. Apologies if I did, but sometimes the answers change, and that's kind of cool too. Why do you do what you do?
Because of how it makes me feel. You know, the minute I realized that the thing that was making me feel this way was something that I could do, which was when I was about 9, and I made the connection that these Jewish superhero monsters, that went by the name of Kiss were actually just a whole lot of dorks. I was like, oh my God, I'm going to do this. because of the way it made me feel. I mean, nothing made me as, nothing turned me on as much as music growing up. And so I thought that would be really, really cool to A, be turned on like that regularly, and then hopefully, like you said, pass it on.
Well, I think you absolutely have, and I thank you for it.
Thank you.
And you know, I feel like, you know, I've got my second shot. A lot of the people have been vaccinated and stuff. I feel like there's hope on the horizon.
Yeah.
And I'm really glad we got the chance to talk again.
Yeah, me too, man. Hopefully soon. Be well.
And you as well.
Yeah, enjoy the world once you get out there.
Great. So much, man.
All right, man. Talk to you soon. Thanks.
There he goes. Craig Wedren. What a cool guy. What a cool, cool guy. Let's listen to that latest single of his. ProtonicReversal.com, by the way. For all the archives, all that good stuff. I realize I don't do this back announce nearly so much. I'm going to start doing it. The show is always free. No ads or sponsors, no kidding. It's all on the social media. We also have a new Instagram account, protonic.reversal. So if you're on Instagram, follow that rather than just following me. And yeah, it would be good to it'd be good if you could do that. Craig Wedren's all over the internet as well. So yeah, go find him. Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, all that stuff. And yeah, we're gonna play let's play Go Insane.
Going insane. vicious elbow glove. A finger fan courtship. The case of her bones are softer than loose meat. A day on the belt, so surely I'll get thin. Really rock day. A finger fan courtship. The case of her bones are softer than loose meat. A day on the belt, so surely I'll get thin. Wanna watch.
We'll be right back.
trust me too, that you let me in just to pour me down. Their mouths hold back the rope that goes so that the others may too, that you let me in just to pour me down.
What a song! What a cool band! What a cool guy! What a confluence of coolness that was, Greg Wedren. Fucking love that guy, man. Why don't I have him on like 17 times, like some of the people on this show? Why don't you, Conan? I don't know. Is anybody running this ship? Christ, we talked for like over an hour. I feel like we like barely got started, but you know, hey. That's the way it goes sometimes in the Protonic Reversal game. Just kidding, this is no game. Sure, okay, so this show is Code of Neutron's Protonic Reversal. Thank you so much for listening to it. As always, this has been episode 246. Craig was last on episode 129. It was January of 2019. As we come to the close of our broadcast, you are welcome for that phenomenon show. Name of the show is Conan Neutron's Protonic Reversal. Thank you so much for listening to it.
Signing off, Mr. and Mrs. America.
The show airs Thursdays, 8 p.m. Eastern, 7 Central, 6 Mountain, 5 Pacific, on RadioNope.com. Say yes to Nope. Podcast it later everywhere.
50,000 watts of power.
ProtonicReversal.com for the archives. No ads, no sponsors, no kidding.
I wanna ionize the air.
Always free. But, if you would like to support the show, $1 a month, patreon.com/protonicreversal. We'll get you early access.
Electricity.
Early access, baby. Oh, yeah.
Can you hear me now?
Stay safe out there.
Out on Route 128, in the dark and lonely.
And take it easy.
Got my radio on. Can you hear me now? Now.
welcome to my top 10. I'd like to thank our sponsor. But we haven't got a sponsor. Not if you were the last man on earth. She was prepared to prove it. This one goes out to a special girl. There is no special girl! It's the end of radio. The last announcer plays the last record. The last what? Leaves the transmitter. Circles the globe in search of a listener. Can you hear me now? Really broadcasting if there's no one there to receive. It's the end of radio. As we come to the close of our broadcast day. Radio. Can you hear me now? This had been a real emergency.